प्रपन्नाहम् गुरुपादा रविन्दयु तस्य प्रेरणया तस्य दिव्यादेशम् वदाम्यहम् आनन्दमानन्दकरप्रसन्नम् स्वरूपम् ब्रजभावयुक्तम् योगीन्द्रमीड्यम् वैद्यं गुरुं कृपालुं नमः कमलपादाय नमस्ते कमले वैविधांश्च प्रणोति तस्मै तत्त्वं दिव्यमात्मबुद्धिप्रकाशं मुमुक्षुर्वै शरणमहं प्रपद्ये
Blessed divine souls, we are all so fortunate to be here on the auspicious occasion of Guru Purnima in Gurudham. So let us begin with a prayer that Sri Maharaji himself has composed for all of us.
राधे राधे गोविंद गोविंद राधे 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 गोविंद गोविंद राधे राधे
राधे गोविंद गोविंद राधे
राधे राधे गोविंद गोविंद राधे
भक्ति ना दे मुक्ति ना दे वैकुंठ ना क्षण हरि गुरु स्मरण करा दे
क्षण क्षण हरि गुरु स्मरण करा दे
क्षण क्षण हरि गुरु स्मरण करा
जय हो गुरुवर 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 जय हो गुरुव
on the most auspicious, the most important festival or day of the year, that is Guru Purnima. Why is Guru Purnima the most important? Because it is in honor of, it is in glorification of the Guru, who is the most important entity, the highest entity. Now, I'm not saying this from my side. This has been declared by no less a personality than Vedavyas, the one who wrote the Vedanta, Brahma Sutra, the 18 Puranas, the Mahabharata Puran, which contains the Bhagavad Gita. He stated, Nasti Tattvam Guru Param. There is no entity higher than the Guru. Tattvam Guru Samam Nasti. There is no entity equal to the Guru. Mind you, Vedavyas is a dissension of God. So there is no doubt about his authority. We have to understand, try to understand, why this entity Guru has been stated as the highest entity, the supreme entity. Now for me to say even one word on this subject is making an unauthorized attempt. However, unworthy as I am, I'm only here to share with you the divine wisdom, the authentic divine wisdom of the scriptures that comes from the topmost authority today, the fifth original Jagat Guru, Jagat Gurutam Sri Kripaluji Maharaj. He has extracted for us the absolute essence of a wide ocean of scores of scriptures. And his miraculous explanation of every aspect of the divine science is unparalleled. So let us begin. The subject I have to cover is the most important subject, and there is so much to share. So I request all of you to listen very attentively. When we look around in this world, what do we see? There's so much of diversity everywhere. No two things look alike. 8.4 million forms of life. Appearance is different. Living habits are different. Their likes and dislikes are totally different. Take, for instance, the human species. I'm sure you know that even twins don't look exactly alike. Amazing. The thumbprint of 7.8 billion people on this earth today is totally different. What a mastermind the Creator must be. You will be surprised to learn that even two leaves of the same tree are not exactly alike. Even the fruit on the same tree, there is a difference in taste. And yet, in the middle of all this diversity, there is one thing common, one thing which is universal. Each and everyone desires only one thing, and that is happiness. It is amazing. Not only human beings, from the ant to Brahma, each and every living being desires happiness. Why? A big question, why? Most people never give it a thought. And material science has got no explanation for this. Our whole life revolves around happiness. I want, I want, I want. But there's hardly a handful who give a thought to the why and what of this goal. It is only the divine science that explains this, both logically and scientifically. Now, although all living beings desire happiness, next point is that only human beings can attain the knowledge of why they desire happiness, what is happiness, and how we can attain happiness. And attaining this knowledge, when it is put into practice, when we acquire this knowledge, then we can attain happiness. Only human beings, because only in human life we have the privilege of performing fruit-yielding action. Kratu mayoyam purusha, tasmat kratum kurvita, swatantra kriyamanevai. Now, we have had the privilege of performing fruit-yielding actions through infinite lifetimes. And yet, we haven't attained even a glimpse of that true happiness that we all desire. Why is it so? Have we neglected this goal of happiness? Or have we been lazy about it? No, not at all. Sukhaya karmani karoti loko. Every action, each and every action that we have performed, are performing and will perform, the aim behind it is only happiness. And not only that, the scriptures add another law. Nahi kanchit charamapi jatu tishtate karma krit. 3.5 Bhagavad Gita, and we have the same verse in the Bhagavad Puran, 6.144. No one can remain inactive even for a fraction of a second. Therefore, every second, every action, the purpose behind it has been only happiness. We have been striving for this goal every moment. Then, why have we not attained this goal? There must be some reason for it. There is. Vedavyas gives us the answer. The root cause of not attaining our ultimate, our supreme goal of happiness is ignorance. Ignorance. Ignorance about what happiness is, how to attain happiness. Why haven't we attained happiness till today? Once we attain this knowledge that ignorance is removed, we will experience the true happiness. And ignorance is the cause of every suffering that we are going through.
this 8.4 million species, the cycle of birth and death, the stress, the dissatisfaction, everything is due to ignorance. Now we have tried. We have tried to remove this ignorance, but one blunder mistake that we have made is we have tried to remove the ignorance with our own efforts. Let me read this book, I will read that book, let me do that, let me try this, all sorts of techniques. But ignorance hasn't gone, because this ignorance is not a joke. It is a very deep-rooted disease of infinite lifetimes. For infinite lifetimes, we have considered ourselves as this physical body, and therefore we have engaged in a relentless search for happiness in this material world, which where the happiness is totally, totally opposite of what our inner being desires. We desire everlasting, unlimited, ever-increasing happiness. This is our nature. And we are searching for it ignorantly in this world where everything is limited, everything is impermanent, and every happiness follows the law of diminishing returns. So with all our efforts, it's not surprising, because even little habits that we have formed in this life, say for 30 years, 40 years, you know, some people, they are chain smokers, some people are alcoholics, family is unhappy, the doctors are warning them, and yet they find it so difficult to give up this little habit of 40 to 50 years. And some of them, I have met such people, they say, well, everybody has to die one day, so what if I die smoking? Even those people who don't smoke, they die, so I will die, I just can't give this up. So how can we remove, how can we get rid of this disease of ignorance, which is of infinite lifetimes? For this, we will have to approach one whose ignorance has been dispelled. The one who has attained that supreme, ultimate divine bliss which we are desiring, and such a personality is called a guru. Now in the world today, the moment people hear the word guru, they want to switch off. They don't want to know anything, because there are so many fakes, so many imposters, and so many different kinds of stories they hear. So they have an apprehension, they fear, they have doubts, and they wonder and ask, is the guru really necessary? Can't we attain that goal on our own? After all, we are educated. What is the need of a guru? Now, historically, no great religion has begun without a great master or saint. It is a fact. Show me one great religious movement or philosophical movement which has originated without an enlightened master. Let us think about this with common sense. When it comes to material studies, has anyone become a doctor or a lawyer or an engineer without approaching a teacher, without guidance? Why knowledge is in books, and today it is all there in social media. People boast about social media today, don't they? Everything is on multimedia, you can learn from there. But don't forget that knowledge has been uploaded by a master. It's not something that has fallen from above. And basically, the very alphabet, just think, forget about these great big degrees, doctors and engineers and lawyers. Even the basic alphabets we learn from a teacher, didn't we? So how can we possibly learn those subtle truths of the divine science, the subtleties of the soul, of the mind, of this creation, of life beyond without a teacher? It is absolutely impossible. When we need a teacher for material knowledge, we definitely need a teacher. A teacher is indispensable, a guru is indispensable for attaining knowledge of the divine science. Now, this is a law laid down by the Supreme Personality, God Himself. Tad vigyanartham sadguru meva vigachet. Eva, only the guru. There is no second choice, no. You have to approach the guru. The knowledge is all there in the scriptures, but you will not be able to understand that profound knowledge in a million lifetimes. You may be a scholar in Sanskrit. You may have all the dictionaries piled up in your home to look at what is written and have translations. Impossible. Vedavyas very clearly says, Anantam param gambhiram durvigahyam samudravat. 11:21-36. The truths of the scriptures are very, very profound. Parokshavado vedoyam. 11:3-44. One word means one thing at one place and it means something else at another place. How can we possibly know? The word Atma could apply to we individual souls, it could apply to a saint, it could even apply to the Supreme Personality God. How will we, with our ignorant minds, understand what the meaning of the word is and where? Impossible. That's why Vedavyas warns us, Anadya vidya yuktasya purushashvatma vedanam svatona sambhavantanyas tatvagyo jnanado bhave. Don't try to touch these scriptures on your own. Go to one who is well versed, who's an authority on the scriptures. The Bhagavad Gita, a dialogue in which God comes face to face with man. It begins with Arjun, representing mankind. He pretends to be ignorant, to be deluded. And although he knew that Sri Krishna is the Supreme Lord, he was very wise. When it came to attaining guidance, when it came to dispelling his ignorance, he approached Sri Krishna saying, Shishyasteyam shadhimam tvam prapannam 2:7. I'm a surrendered disciple. I accept you as my guru. Please guide me. My mind is in a complete broken state. I'm grieved, I'm confused. He didn't say to Sri Krishna, you are the Supreme Lord, you guide me. Because if he had said that, Sri Krishna would have given a point blank answer. I'm sorry, go and look for a guru. This is not my department. All the scriptures scriptures, we have thousands and thousands of verses emphatically emphasizing the indispensability of a guru on the spiritual path. We have a very beautiful verse in the Bhagavad Puran, which is a capsule of spiritual wisdom. You know, Sri Maharaj always quotes it, and when he quotes it, he says, it's a very beautiful verse, one of my favorites. Bhayam dvitiya bhinivesha tasya dishad petasya viparyayo smiti. Bhaktai kayesham gurudeva tatma 11-37. Why are we suffering? Why are we bound by Maya? And since when have we been bound by Maya? And what is the way out? Everything in one verse. Why are we suffering? Because of forgetfulness. We have forgotten our real identity. Therefore, we have forgotten who is mine, our relationship with God. And due to this body identification, we have a deep-rooted attachment to this material world. What is the way out? Accept the Guru as the soul of your soul and practice devotion to Lord Krishna under his guidance. Everything in a nutshell, in one verse. Acharyam, Acharyavan Purusho Hi Veda, 6.14.2, Chandogya Upanishad, Tasmat Gurum Prapadyeta, 11.3.21, Shikshet Guruatma Daivata, 11.3.22, Vinamahat Pada Rajo Vishekam, 5.12.12. Millions of verses. The Tibetan Book of Living and Dying states the only way to enlightenment and liberation is following an authentic spiritual master. The founder of the Zen school of Buddhism said that unless you find a teacher soon, you will live this life in vain. Ramakrishna Paraman said, I'm the sanctuary. Give me the power of attorney and I will release you from the bonds of karma. Guru Binu Bhavanidhi Tarai Na Koi Ramayana. Naraji puts up a question. Kastarati kastarati mayan. How can one cross this boundless ocean of maya? Yo mahanubhavam sevate sutra number 46. Answer in the same sutra. By selflessly serving. The same thing is said in the Gita. Tadvidit pradipatena parikprashnena sevaya. Submissive spirit, service, and questioning with curiosity. So it's obvious that a guru is indispensable. Why haven't we attained our goal till today? Because we have never recognized a saint. We have never accepted a saint or as a guru till today. That's why we have not attained our goal so far. That is why the Vedas say, Uttishtata Jagrata Prapya Varan Nibodata. Awake, arise and go to a genuine saint, a guru, not to God, to the saint, and with his guidance attain your supreme goal. So let us understand briefly. As I said right from the beginning, the subject is very vast. I'm going step by step, but briefly, for you to be able to grasp the entire matter. Who is a guru? When it comes to teachers, when it comes to doctors in the material world, there are degrees, there are signboards, there are qualifications. What about a spiritual master, a guru? The signboard, the qualification of a guru is in the word guru itself. Gu shabdaspandakarasya ru shabdastannirodhaka dvayopnishad. Shri Maharaji writes, Gu ka artha mayatam govindradhe, ru ka artha nash kare sabko bata de. So who is a guru? The one who dispels the darkness of ignorance, the one who dispels, who removes maya, the one who frees you from suffering and gives you the light of knowledge. Shrotriyam Brahmanishtam, Mundaka Upanishad 1.2.12. Shabde Pareja Nishnyatam, 11.3.21, Bhagavad Puran. Jnaninas Tattva Darshina, 4.34, Bhagavad Gita. Two important qualifications that have been mentioned is that a guru is one who is well-versed, one who has an authoritative knowledge of all the scriptures, and he has practically experienced, that is to say, he is God-realized. Now, such a saint, he does everything for you, from A to Z, right from the beginning to the end. The first thing is, I told you, dispelling ignorance is very important because it's very deep-rooted. If ignorance is not dispelled, how can we attain the right knowledge? So first thing is dispelling ignorance, then giving us the gist, the essence of all the scriptures. Who am I? Who is mine? What is this material world about? What is the purpose of life? How do we attain it? What is this mind? And so on and so forth. So all this knowledge is given to us in a gist on our level. And then again, what is the spiritual practice that we can engage in to attain our goal? And finally, when through this spiritual practice, the mind is purified, then it is the guru who showers that ultimate divine bliss and love on that deserving soul. Guru karave jnana hariku shruti puranan pyare. Guru batave hari milan ki sadhana bhi pyare, sadhana bhi pyare. Shuddh man ho jaye to guru prem bhi de pyare.
the Guru is with us.
So he does everything. What do we have to do? From our side, we have to submissively attach the mind to him. Just as we attach the mind to a doctor, just as we attach the mind to a teacher to learn English, in the same way, attach your mind to this perfect personality. And the Vedas guide us in this respect. Yasya deve para bhaktir yatha deve tatha guru Shvetashvatara Upanishad 6:23, Yogshika Upanishad 2:22, is there in a number of Upanishads. Yasya deve mantra kahe go. Yasya deve mantra kahe Govind Radhe Hari Guru ki bhakti ek si ho bata de. We should worship God and the Guru in the same way. Guru Reva Hari Saksha. He's the Supreme Personality Himself. You may call Him Guru, you may call Him God. It's the same thing, there is no difference. Guru Neva Haris Sakshat, Brahma Vidyopanishad 31 says, He's the Supreme Personality Himself. Esha Vai Bhagavan Sakshat, 7:15:27. Yasya Sakshat Bhagavati, 7:15:26. Bhagavat Puran. The Guru alone is God, and God alone is the Guru. Acharyam Mam Vijaniyam. Sri Krishna is saying, it's me. I am the Guru. I am the one who guides you. Devata Bandava Santa Santa Atma Ahameva Cha. 11:26:34 Bhagavad Puran. It is me. He comes to you in his human form as a saint. So God, as God himself, is of no use to us. When that same Supreme Personality comes to us in the form of a teacher, in the form of a guru, only then can we be guided and we can attain our goal. I remember the words of the Sufi saint Jalaluddin Rumi when he met his spiritual master for the first time. These are his words. The God whom I had worshipped all my life came today in human form. So the Guru, I said, is the most important personality. Why? Now we have a bit of understanding why he has been declared to be the highest personality. However, in this age of Kali Yuga, the greatest problem before a spiritual aspirant is to find a bona fide guru. You know, Kali Yuga is an age of hypocrisy and quarrel. And there are so many pseudo-gurus, so many self-proclaimed gurus. And to make matters even more difficult, the social media, there is a tidal wave of gurus and paths. How can an ordinary person in the world decide who is genuine and who is not? Who has the understanding, complete understanding, and who has the time? It's extremely difficult, but a guru is indispensable. What do you do? So looking at this imperative need, this confused state of affairs in Kali Yuga, the degree of Jagat Guru was established. Now Jagat Guru means the teacher of the whole world. A saint who brings about a revolution in the world with his divine teachings. Such a personality is honored with this degree of Jagat Guru, and he is one who is the topmost in authority, in knowledge of the scriptures, and obviously he is one who has attained the ultimate goal of divine bliss. Now such a person can be approached without fear of being deceived, and therefore in Kali Yuga the first Jagat Guru, all of you have heard his name, Adi Jagat Guru Shankaracharya, he was honored with this title of Jagat Guru, and he was followed by Jagat Guru Nilmarkacharya, then Ramanujacharya, and finally Jagat Guru Madhavacharya. These are all authentic, original Jagat Gurus. They are not self-proclaimed Jagat Gurus as we have today. So many number of self-proclaimed Jagat Gurus, and the number is increasing. These are all original Jagat Gurus. They had engaged in scriptural debate with all the scholars, all the contemporary scholars at that time, and they had emerged victorious, therefore they were honored with this degree of Jagat Guru. So people approached them for attaining spiritual guidance and also to know the method of spiritual practice. There was no question of being deceived because they were appointed personalities. They were proved to be authentic, bona fide spiritual masters. However, for us today, to accept any of these four Jagat Gurus as a guru and receive guidance from their writings is not possible. Why? Because most of their writings, in fact all their writings, were in Sanskrit and very, very profound. Only scholars could understand what they have written in their commentaries. So what do? We don't need to worry at all, because for us today, and for the coming generations, we have the most authentic, the topmost of all gurus, the fifth original Jagat Guru, Jagat Guruttam Sri Kripaluji Maharaj. He made accessible all those profound truths of the scriptures to even the common man. His innate ability, natural ability, to express the profoundest truths in simple but intellectual, logical, and at the same time, his entire philosophy was colored with day-to-day examples, practical examples from our life. So because of this innate ability of his to come down to the level of ordinary man and his vast, unparalleled knowledge, he was honored with a degree, with the title of not only Jagadguru, but Jagadgurutam, the supreme among all the previous Jagadgurus. He was conferred this title by the Kashi Vidvat Parishad, which is India's highest spiritual body, consisting of all the distinguished scholars of the Vedas and scriptures. So Sri Maharaji, as he is lovingly called, addressed this august assembly of 500 eminent scholars, and he was only 34 years at that time. He spoke in Sanskrit for 9 days, quoting extensively from all the scriptures. And at the same time, he reconciled all the contradictions in all the philosophies and faiths with such masterly ease that all the scholars were left speechless and spellbound. His scriptural scholarship far surpassed the combined knowledge of the scriptures. Nobody could even stand up, even dare to debate with him. Forget debating with him. They all bowed down to this remarkable young man, whom they all felt is not an ordinary man, but a dissension, a divine dissension, who has come to awaken the world and bring about a revolution in spirituality. So today, we are fortunate to have this bona fide spiritual master, Jagadgurutam, the fifth original Jagadguru, Jagadgurutam Sri Kripaluji Maharaj. He is the guru of all gurus, and all these 500 scholars unanimously accepted the fact that he was the topmost spiritual genius of this age today. How very fortunate we are that his divine teachings are all available to us today. This is all the blessing of technology and an enormous array of invaluable spiritual wealth in the form of audio, visual material is available to us. So Sri Maharaji is virtually a living master for us. We can easily accept him as a guru. Everyone can, because he is a proved authority. Some people have a question in this regard. Those who have limited knowledge, understanding of what Maharaji taught, they question they agree that Sri Maharaj is the topmost authority and his teachings are absolutely wonderful, amazing, down to earth. But how can I accept him as a guru? Because today he's not physically present. How will I be initiated? Sri Maharaj did not initiate anyone, not even one person with a mantra in his entire life. I said to you, such personalities, they come about to bring a revolution, to bring about an awakening about what true spiritual knowledge from the scriptures is. So he taught everyone what initiation is actually. Divya Jnana, Divya Prema, Govinda Radhe, Jap Guru Devaya, Diksha Batade. He always spoke against the system, this business of initiating today, which was only there by so-called teachers to have more and more, a big collection of disciples. So, no Jagat Guru has ever been as accessible to everyone as Sri Maharaj is today. He has not only brought the profound knowledge of the scriptures to our doorstep, but today, we can hold him in our hands and connect to him anytime and anywhere, as many times as possible via our mobile phone. He's all yours. A Jagat Guru is at your beck and call. When you listen to his inspiring, penetrating, enlightening lectures, his enchanting sankirtans, which are steeped with the nectar of divine love, you will, within no time, experience an effortless, amazing spiritual transformation in your life. A few decades back, it was not possible for anyone to be round the clock whole life with any guru. But today, it is possible. People watch 1 billion hours of YouTube videos per day and 500 hours per minute of videos uploaded on YouTube. So social media has become a part and parcel of our daily lives, and we can use this very social media for our spiritual upliftment. We can connect so easily to the supreme Jagat Guru of this age and benefit from his teachings and be with him all the time. We can see how he looked, we can see how he spoke, we can watch him singing in ecstasy, which has never been seen in the world ever since Lord Chaitanya. We can see how he related to people, how he gathered everyone in his divine embrace, irrespective of caste, creed, and country. However, those who are sincere spiritual aspirants should be cautious of this very same social media, because from time to time there are some in the world who have got nothing to do excepting criticize saints and even genuine saints. One false rumor, one made up story about them, and it can bring doubts to millions of minds. But as far as Jagat Guru Uttam Shri Kripaluji Maharaj is concerned, I have just told you that he was unanimously accepted as the topmost spiritual genius of the age. And you have heard a proverb, the proof of the pudding is in the eating. First of all, we have the proof of Kashi Vidvat Parishad declaring his Jagat Guru Uttam supreme among all Jagat Gurus. And then again, the transformation, the effortless ease which you are able to move on the spiritual path is a proof for you. In the recent past, so many people actually formed an internal link with Sri Maharaji without even meeting him. And they just watch a video or something else, a photo or something, and they were drawn towards him. And he came into their lives as their guru forever, even before they met him. And this is happening even today. He's not physically present, but millions and millions of people are listening to him. They are benefiting, they are progressing spiritually. And while listening to him, they are actually feeling his physical presence with them. So today, those people who are seekers, who desire to follow a genuine and authentic, a bona fide guru, we have Jagat Guru Uttam, one who is declared to be the topmost, the supreme Jagat Guru of today's age, and technology has made everything available. He's a living guru for the whole world. Today, his three learned daughters, who are following in the footsteps of their great father, are constantly, ceaselessly working to carry forward his legacy of love and devotion. They are the very apostles of dedication, of devotion, of selfless love. We are truly indebted to them because they are engaged in keeping the teachings of Sri Maharaji available to the whole world. And not only that, we can learn from them what Guru Bhakti is. They're the personifications of Guru Bhakti for us. Now on this auspicious occasion of Guru Purnima, what can we offer to the supreme spiritual master of the whole world? The dissension of divine love devotion. Before we even think of offering anything, let us see what the scriptures say in this regard. Prithivyam nasti tadravyam yadgatva chanrino bhave manusmriti. Sara vishva dan karo Govind Radhe to bhi guru rena tena urena batana.
lotus feet of the Guru, we will never be free of our indebtedness to him. When we consider what these scriptures say, Radha Govind Geet says, then to even think that we have given anything or we can give anything is a blasphemy. In truth, it was Sri Maharaji who gave, who is giving, and who will always give us, because his very name is Kripalu, the merciful one, the giver of grace, the dispensation of grace. Tu to kripa ki hai avtari, tera rom rom kripa pyari. Tu to khate pite sote pyare, soche kripa 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 pyari. Sri Maharaji has composed these lines for Radharani, but they apply to him who is the dissension of Radharani's causeless mercy and love. Let me share with you what happened when Sri Maharaji composed these lines. It was in the year 2007, and he had an eye surgery in Delhi. And the doctor said to him before he was leaving, knowing his personality, that you have to be very careful for a day or two. Don't strain yourself, don't speak, don't sing, because it will strain your eyes. Now on the way home, Sri Maharaji said to me, remind me about this because I tend to forget. I was very happy that I'm going to remind Maharaji that he is not going to speak or sing. However, when he came home, within no time, Sri Maharaji was sitting outside with all the devotees. The chanting was on. And he started singing these very lines. Tu to khate pite sote pyari, soche kripa 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 pyari. Now I was trying to desperately catch his attention, to warn him not to speak, but he deliberately didn't look towards me. And after he had finished composing the line, he directly looked at me and gave me a smile. And then I realized what he was saying, that he is a dissension of grace. He's helpless, he can't help himself. He's not bothered about his health or anything. He must just grace and grace and grace. So those lines are applied to him. This torrential downpour of grace is there in the world even today. What we have to learn is how to receive, to be more and more deserving to receive this grace. Kripa mangana sikha de pyari, kripa bana de adhikari. He has taught us, even this he has taught us, how to be recipients of grace.
tells us the same thing. Shishu bani karu krandana bhaju aave nandanandana. You don't have to do anything except come to the state of an innocent little child and shed tears. Just cry out to him and he'll be there. The day that cry from is from the bottom of our hearts, he will himself come and wipe our tears and grant us that supreme divine bliss and his eternal service, for which we can never, ever, ever be free of his indebtedness. We will remain eternally indebted to this supreme authority, the supreme guru of the entire world.
बोलिए जगद्गुरु उत्तम श्री कृपालु महाराज की, प्यारी प्यारी अम्मा की, श्री भक्ति धाम की, जय जय श्री राधे, जय जय श्री राधे, जय जय श्री राधे।